Because really what you want to do is gain the experience, because from the experience, that's what will grow your business. Especially early on, you're going to make some mistakes. Mistakes are okay. We have built our business off of failures. There's a lot of failures that happen for us, but we continue to push forward. Welcome to another Sunday Night Live. I've made a commitment to myself and to my team that I will be doing a Sunday Night Live every single week for the entirety of 2021. So I'm just putting that out there for accountability. And accountability is super important. I know for me and my team, we like to keep each other accountable. So who better to be accountable to than all of you as well, that every single Sunday night or Sunday in the afternoon, I'll be doing a live from my home or wherever I am, providing you as much value as possible, because that's the name of the game here. We want to see you grow collectively. So the way it goes is pretty open. You just ask questions, I answer them. You know, it's kind of like a live Q&A for everybody who's either A, trying to start a business, B, selling on Amazon, C, considering starting to sell on Amazon and need some guidance, or if you have any questions that need addressing. That's essentially what this is for, and I'm happy to help. And there's really no questions I won't answer. And if there are any, I'll just let you know, like, hey, I'm not comfortable answering that. But we got some people joining here. First in, let's get it. Brian, what's up? Sunday night jam session. You already know, my friend. So if you got any questions, just leave them in the comments. I will address them. What is the wave said? How do you deal with trying to get the buy box if there's 9 others that competing for it, and every time you go lower, they do too? So what I would do is analyze Keepa, check their stock levels, and make sure that maybe they only have 2 days worth of stock. Maybe 5 of those 9 sellers will be sold out in a week, and then I'd kind of hold my price where it is and then wait that week to get the buy box. Also, you could run some low bid advertisements on them, some low bid PPC campaigns. I'm talking, you know, 10 to 20 cents per click PPC campaigns, and I would run those. And just from my experience, Amazon's a little more likely to give the buy box to someone who's running a PPC campaign, especially if we're all at the same price, because the way Amazon sees it is they get to make a little bit more money off of the seller who's running ads. Because if the buy box is you and you're running ads, when that person clicks buy, they're not only making money off the FBA fees and the pick and pack fee, or the pick and pack fees and the referral fees, but now they're making an additional 10 to 20 cents from the advertising. Doesn't seem like a lot, 10 to 20 cents, but when you multiply it by millions, tens of millions of orders, 10 million orders, that's $1 million. That they're making additional, and they ship literally hundreds of millions of orders a year, if not in the billions. They ship ridiculous amount of orders. It's literally ridiculous how many orders they ship. Someone asked, what services software do you use for accounting, or is it in-house? So for accounting, we use QuickBooks. Our repricer manages our cost of goods, so we have our cost of goods in our repricer that spits out a gross profit number, because it's just basically listing revenue minus FBA fees, which include pick and pack and referral fees, minus any cost of advertising, minus any inventory cost, and then also minus the cost of goods. And then what's left of that is gross profit. And from that gross profit, that's really where accounting comes in, and having proper accounting is crucial to operating a successful Amazon business. And where that comes is you need to know your expenses, documenting everything from, you know, cost of labor to warehouse space, if you have one, to cost of shipping, all those things that aren't accounted for. And we use QuickBooks for that. And we also have a CPA who looks at our books weekly to make sure everything's lined up. And then we have an accountant who reviews what the CPA puts together to make sure that we're paying our quarterly taxes on time and we're really staying on top of what we need to be staying on top of. Who's this? 78 said, I am new on Amazon and I'm not sure where to start and what products to sell. Any suggestions? Yeah, so I would say definitely spend some time exploring our YouTube content on youtube.com, because, and this video will be up there, so you know you can rewatch this and reference it if you'd like to, but definitely spend some time just exploring what other sellers are selling. I know from us, just on our YouTube channel, we talk about some of the best categories that we sell in, and those being grocery and health and personal care. Those are some of, they make up 65% of our total sales, those two categories. So we capitalize on those products. I'm talking about brand name products that people trust already. People know what they are. People know how they feel, know how they taste. Like their Old Spice deodorant, they know it removes the sweat under their pits. They buy it anyway. So we prefer and we suggest, if you're just getting started, stick with brand name products that people trust already, so you don't have to worry about advertising. You don't have to worry about marketing the product, and you can get some sales and get some revenue generated, because really what you want to do is gain the experience, because from the experience, that's what will grow your business, especially early on. You're going to make some mistakes. Mistakes are okay. We have built our business off of failures. There's a lot of failures that happen for us, but we continue to push forward. So I would say for you, start reaching out, opening some wholesale accounts, purchasing some brand name products, or even go to your local stores, do some retail arbitrage. And that's as simple as using the Sellers app or one of these additional applications that you can purchase. I recommend using the Sellers app because you're already paying the $39.99 a month and you have access to it. And just scan in some products right there in the store. You literally scan the UPC. It comes up if it's profitable or not. Now, the only suggestion I would have is if you're using the Sellers app and you plan on purchasing a lot of that inventory, make sure you're exploring the Keepa chart. Now, on the Sellers app, the Amazon Sellers app, there is no Keepa chart. There are some softwares that allow you to populate a Keepa chart on your cell phone. So definitely you want to be checking that Keepa chart. And I know what we used to do is we'd go to Costco and we'd put together $40,000 orders from our phone. And then we'd take one more step. We'd literally go back to the office and we'd re-research all those products just to double check, because that's a nice hefty purchase order, $40,000. We'd go double check and analyze, like, okay, what do the competitive sellers look like? What does Amazon's presence look like? How much profit are we making consistently? And then we'd literally go back the next day and then purchase all those products. So it really depends on what you're purchasing. If you're getting ones and twos of products, then you don't have to go that deep. But if you are going to be purchasing a lot of inventory, I always suggest analyzing the Keepa chart. What filters do you use before you consider buying a product for wholesale? What do you mean filters? Like through a UPC scraper, what filters are we using? I'm going to assume it's that. And I would say the filters we're using, we're setting a minimum profit. For us, that's $2. For you, it's whatever you need it to be to generate profit based on your expenses. But I recommend most sellers starting at minimum profit of $2, because if you're trying to grow a successful Amazon business, the name of the game is volume. You want to sell as much products as possible. I know there's sellers out there and I can't knock it. It's what they do. That's their hustle. It's just not ours. They want to be making minimum $8, $9, $10 every time they sell a product, which is great, but it's not good for the long term. It's not going to grow a large Amazon business. And my goal and Sebastian's goal early on was to grow a big Amazon business, so we have a presence and we have respect on the marketplace. And that's kind of what we did from selling a lot of products early on at lower profit margins. But we're perfectly okay with it because now we've built a monster Amazon business. But so there's two filters I'm setting for price. I'm setting a minimum profit dollar and a maximum profit dollar. And the reason I like to set a maximum profit dollar on my repricer is because sometimes the repricer is pulling information that is inaccurate. So you might get usually the max profit based on the catalog I'm looking at. If it's a regular health and personal care catalog with shampoos, deodorants, conditioners, I'm setting it right around $20, because you're gonna get some results that populate in your UPC scraper that are like $30, $40, and you're gonna be like, holy crap, this is amazing. This is so much money. How am I making so much money? And then you're gonna realize that it's just the incorrect listing. It's pulling the incorrect information, or on Amazon, the UPC is connected inaccurately. So what we like to do is set a max profit as well. And then we're definitely setting a rank limitation as well. We're doing anything greater than one. So if it's one or higher, I'm looking at it. And then depending on, once again, what type of catalog I'm scraping, we're putting a max rank. And usually for us, it's around 300,000. And a lot of you, once again, you're probably saying 300,000, that's really high. But once again, it's based on profit. If I find a listing that's ranked 300,000 and I'm making $40 on it in profit, I know I can drop it $15 and I could still make, you know, 25 bucks in profit, and I could crush it with that listing. So I'm perfectly comfortable picking up those higher ranked products. So JBands_ said, wanting to branch into wholesale UK, I'm a small time seller. What advice would you give and what methods would you advise to find suitable products? So my first advice, my honest advice, JBands, would be if you're a small seller in the United States, you should really consider if that's where you're located. Well, really, regardless of where you're located, if it's a different country other than the UK, which I'm assuming it is because that's where you're considering going, I would say first master the art. First, master the art of selling on Amazon in whatever country you're in before you go spreading yourself too thin. And now you're going to find yourself in a position where you're trying to grow an Amazon US account, Amazon.com account, an Amazon.UK account, and you're going to be focusing on two, putting all your energy into both of them instead of having 100% of energy on one and growing that successfully, start seeing great returns. And then maybe 6 months from now, 9 months from now, branching out and being like, okay, now it's time. I understand enough of this information to be like, wow, now it's time to branch into another country, another marketplace, because I understand the current marketplace that I'm listing in. And I see this happen. We were just talking about this in Clubhouse today. And for all of you who aren't on Clubhouse, definitely sign up for Clubhouse. Right now, it's restricted only to iPhone users. I actually bought an iPhone just to watch and join in on Clubhouse. It's essentially like live podcasting. It's really crazy. We've had a great time in the past couple days, but we were just talking about this today. That so many, you know, new up and coming entrepreneurs, like the cool thing to be, right? Everybody wants to be an entrepreneur. So they start one business and then they start to lose focus, and then they go into another business, and the first business didn't even see Uber success, and then they start another business, and then they just never build anything really large. So my honest opinion, JBands, would be before you go selling in another country, make sure you have everything prepared and you're fully focused on the current marketplace you're selling on. Don't get me wrong, there's a ton of opportunity in the United Kingdom, and you could just search, go to Amazon.UK and start searching those products. A lot of these UPC scrapers, they connect to the United Kingdom as well, so you could use them the same way you would research products in the United States. The beautiful thing about Amazon is it's universal. A lot of these marketplaces are almost identical, with the exception of some of the brands that are selling on them. But ranking systems are the same. So much information is the same. It's pretty crazy. EJR_SSG said, do you have as much knowledge in private label as you do wholesale? So my expertise is in wholesale, and I also have expertise in private label. I would say absolutely I have as much knowledge in private label as I do wholesale. Private label makes up about 15% of our business. So what is that? 40 million would be 400,000 would be 10, or no, 4 million would be 10%. So yeah, about $8 million a year. I would say $5 to $8 million a year of our sales are private label. So we have tons of experience, tons of failures too, don't get me wrong. We made a lot of private label products that just didn't take off. I created one maybe 6 months ago. It was our first grocery private label product. And let me tell you this for sure, I found out how competitive grocery is. It was a trail mix snack. And I got it listed, was super excited about it. I had four different varieties, a bar mix, a trail mix, a fruit and nut mix, a chocolate mix. I was super excited, dumped some advertising into it, ended up selling it for a loss. It taught me a lot about the industry, so I don't see it as a loss. It might have been an immediate financial loss, but you can't put a number on the knowledge that was gained from experiencing that. You just can't put a number on that. You can't. And I say it all the time, invest in yourself, invest in your future. I made one of the best investments I ever made in my life about a year ago. I ended up spending maybe $6,000 to $8,000, me and Sebastian. We went to this convention in Nashville, and it literally changed our whole perspective in the course of our entire lives. It was the best $8,000 I personally ever spent on myself. And I still continue to invest and learn. So it's important to do so. Was scanning books today for my first FBA shipment. There was one that scanned for $162 new. It looked new, but wasn't in plastic. Can it not be sold new, or what is your advice to get it to Amazon? So here's the thing with books. You definitely want to be honest about how you're conditioning your books. You want to be honest with that. The last thing you want to do is list a book as new and the customer gets it and they're complaining. They want to return it because, hey, this isn't new. And who's going to know if it's new or not? You're going to know. So just be honest with yourself. If it's questionable, then it's not new. It could be used new or like new, but it's not new. So just be honest with yourself when you're listing books, because you don't want those dings on your account from selling used products as new. It's not a good look. Amazon doesn't like it. And the end consumer, who's the most important person in the transaction, they don't like it either. So you definitely want to be transparent about that. 100%. What you think is the average ROI for this business? Here's the thing. We don't look at ROI because ROI is very, it's deceiving, right? Because let's say 15% ROI, right? 15% ROI on a $100 product, that's 15 bucks. That's pretty reasonable. 15% on a $2 product, that's 30 cents. Not too exciting. So ROI is a bad indicator. It's just not the greatest. It's not bad. It's not the greatest indicator to judge an Amazon business by. What we prefer to judge our Amazon business by is gross margins and net margins. And I would say just for kind of a ballpark range, what you should be shooting for gross margins is right around a healthy Amazon company, 18 to 25%. If you're a little lower, that's okay, especially if you're just starting off. If you're at 12 or 15, but you're just starting, that's okay. Don't beat yourself up about that. It takes time to grow your business and grow your profit margins, as well as your review count and your seller feedback, all of that. It takes time, so be patient. M2 said, not a question. Okay, but I love the classes you guys have. A bunch of great info. $3,000 is a hefty price, but in the end, I know it will all be worth it. I can promise you it will be worth it. I just know for a fact it will be worth it. You know, we're Amazon sellers. That's what I do for a living. My 9-to-9 is Amazon seller, you know, so I know exactly what you need to be successful. And I put it all together in a nice little course. It's actually a really big course. It's almost 100 hours of content. And I'm loving that you're loving it. That makes me excited. Sports cards are fire. Also, guys, we own a card shop and love seeing all the new people. Yeah, listen, there's a lot of opportunities. Sports cards are kind of coming back. I remember in like the mid-90s. Yeah, I guess it was the mid-90s. I was huge into sports cards. Huge. I'm talking, I had the binders with all the sports cards in it and the plastic cases and like all this stuff. And my father, I don't know what I did with mine. I probably threw them out when I moved or something. But my father still has a huge, I'm talking huge, tens of thousands of sports cards in our basement. So I was actually talking to my mom the other day and I was like, maybe we should, you know, encourage him to maybe bring someone into the house to kind of go through these and see if there's some value there. Because he had some great cards, some Ken Griffey Juniors, some throwback. It's just some great cards in there. The Book Bandito. So would it be wise to get a good high velocity product and move to purchasing either at Costco or Sam's Club due to no wholesale account available? Listen, it's an opportunity. You just walk in there and you could buy them right off the floor. And if you're going to be buying them from one of these clubs, you want to be looking at the end of the aisles, because the end of the aisles is where they have their discounts. So listen, it's not going to sustain long-term success on Amazon, but it's definitely, if you're just getting started, it's an option to explore. It's definitely an option to explore. So don't hesitate. Don't hesitate. I see it happen all too common, and it hurts. It hurts to see it happen, because I've been there and I know what it's like. And I tell a lot of you and a lot of our peers all the time, like, hey, just don't beat yourself up if you make a mistake. Like, just keep powerhousing forward, keep moving, keep progressing, because we all make mistakes in the beginning. Some of the most successful people in the world made huge, drastic mistakes that probably almost ruined their businesses. But the difference between them and the people who didn't build monster successful Amazon business is determination. They continued to stay determined, they continued to push forward, and they continued to drive and ensure that their business would be successful no matter what. Do you recommend having more than one Amazon account? How do you do it safely? So Amazon just actually allowed maybe 6 months ago where you can have multiple Amazon accounts. There's some restrictions there. A, you need to communicate it with them, and B, you can't sell the same products on each account. So if you are considering opening a second Amazon account, definitely communicate that with Amazon. We do not have multiple accounts. We have one account, and that's because we want to grow our seller feedback under that one account. Heidi, or hey, Edilu said, Pokemon cards are really popular right now. Who would have guessed? I used to have a huge collection of those too, Pokemon cards. I wish I saved those too. I don't know. Actually, you know what? I should do some digging around at my parents' house. They're probably upstairs in the closet. But yeah, I used to do a ton. I would purchase them at Walmart, and I would go right in the same little strip mall, which I don't even think strip malls exist anymore. Not like the outdoor strip malls. I'm talking like, it was like a mini malls, like indoor, but they had the Walmart and connected. You could walk through this small little mall and it had like a car shop or card store. So I would literally, you know, buy 10 packs of these Pokemon cards. And I was young, I was probably 9 or 10 years old. You know, this was 20 something years ago. And then I would open them all on a bench in the mall. And then any good ones, I'd literally go to the card shop, sell them to the card shop owner. And then I'd go back and buy more. And I just would keep doing this and doing this. I'd pocket a little bit of the profitable money that I made, a little bit of the profits. And then I'd go buy, you know, say I got $50 and I spent $20 on Pokemon cards. I'd pocket that $20 and go spend $30 on more cards and then open those up and then just keep doing that. And I was making decent money. I was a little kid though. So like making $30 in a day, that was huge. That was like so exciting. Jeffer Smith Love. Jeffer, I'm almost hesitant to let you in here only because I don't recognize your name and we've had some, I did some giveaways recently. So sometimes right after I do a giveaway, our audience gets a little diluted. And I don't want to let anybody who's going to devalue this what's happening here. I collected Jordans 10 years ago and have everyone. Yeah, Jordans were huge too. I remember having my fresh pair of Jordans from UK, doing well here in UK. Now what to do? Want to do US with private labeling? What do you think? Yeah. I think if you think it's a good idea, I think it's a good idea. I don't see why not. If you're already successful over in UK, and that's really what separates you from the previous gentleman we were just talking about. Well, doing well here. I don't know what well is. Well is different for everybody. You know, well for you, maybe $10,000 a month. Well, for me, might be $1 million a month. So well is really a perceived word that has different meaning for everybody. So I would say if you've mastered UK, absolutely, slide over to the US. Are distributors you mostly purchase from national and big companies or local? It's a variety of both. We don't discriminate when it comes to distributors. We work with some huge national distributors. We also work with some local guys and some mid-size distributors, and they all provide different valuable products that we make a lot of money on. Some of them have consistent of the same SKUs that we get every 45, every 60 days, and others have a wide variety of SKUs that we get once in a while. So it really depends. Worded the question poorly, my bad. I'm from the UK and doing RA currently, wanting to give wholesale a good go, but seem to hit dead end after dead end. Persistence, my friend. Persistence. Don't give up. Don't quit before the miracle happens. Just don't. It's like, how long you been doing it for? 2 weeks? 3 weeks? A month? Regardless, it's not enough. Keep putting in the work. Keep calling these distributors, because one day the magic, the miracle is going to happen, and you're going to create that account, and it's going to generate, you know, $5,000, $6,000, $7,000 in sales that first month, and you're going to be like, holy crap, like, I just placed a 300 order purchase order, and I didn't even have to go to the store and scan a product or load it into my car. It literally got shipped right to Amazon, or it got shipped right to my storage facility, and I sent it right to Amazon. And this light bulb's gonna go off, my friend. And it's gonna be amazing. It's gonna be a special moment. I'm excited for you. How do you ensure continuity of business with potential Amazon bans? Listen, we've been suspended a few times before, and oh wow, Bitcoin just dropped below $37,000. My alarm just went off. Bitcoin just went below $37. Wow. All right, back to it. Maybe I should just drop out now. I don't know. Lots going on though. Bitcoin's been crazy volatile the last couple days. Crazy ups, crazy downs. I don't own a crazy amount. Maybe, I don't know, $10,000 or $15,000 worth. But I set that alarm because when it went off, I was probably going to jump out and then jump back in because I have a feeling it's going to go lower. But it's going off right now. And I can give it another 10 minutes. Yeah, so continuity. You just remain consistent. And basically, there's very few Amazon suspensions that are impossible to get your account back. Very few Amazon suspensions where it's impossible. Let me repeat that, impossible to get your account back. Now, there's certain ones related to drop shipping or selling used as new, which are very challenging to get your account back, but even those are possible. So just remain consistent. Do you guys also sell in Canada? What is your opinion about this? Amazon Marketplace, I do help people who are starting selling here in Canada. Is that like a shameless plug or is that an actual question? Because it sounds like you first ask, how do we sell in Canada? And then you're like, I help people sell in Canada. So I'm torn, shameless plug question. But yeah, we do sell in Canada. We actually had a little trouble getting our account connected to the NARF program. That's because we were originally part of the Amazon FBA on-site, where they actually flew out to our warehouse and made a section of our warehouse an FBA warehouse. And they gave us their software and their scan guns. So we had to disconnect from that, but we're back at it. So we do sell in Canada, yes. How do you calculate shipping to FBA when you are purchasing? Is there an average cost that you use, or do you calculate for each product you purchase? So this is what I would do based on experience. If you're sending USPS, FedEx, UPS, 50 cents a unit I would put in for shipping, or 50 cents a pound. It's kind of interchangeable based on the products you sell. It really depends though, because 50 cents for us, our average product weighs about 1.5 pounds, right? Our average ASIN. So 50 cents a pound works for us, or 50 cents a unit even works. It's kind of interchangeable because most of our units weigh about a pound. But if you're selling mini refrigerators, or you're selling helmets, like the 50 cents a pound might not work. You might need to go close to a dollar. But here's my numbers. UPS, FedEx, USPS, 50 cents a pound, using small parcel carriers. LTL, 20 cents a pound. Can get it to 15, can get it to 25. Average 20 cents a pound or 20 cents a unit. And then full truckload, 3.5 to 5 cents per unit per pound. Very close. I know for us, it's 3.5 cents a unit, 4 cents a pound to send LTL. Would you consider jumping on a listing where margins are good but price is not stable? Yeah, I would consider it. I'm looking at the Keep It chart. I would definitely consider it. We hop on listings all the time, or maybe even when we buy it, we're not making money. But everything about that Keep It chart ebbs and flows, and usually it's higher. It's just this week, two or three sellers got in, and they only have 10 units each, and they're like, battling to the bottom. And I know they're going to sell out, and the price is going to go back up. It's very volatile, Amazon. And it's volatile for a couple reasons. A, it's supply and demand. The customers know what they want and how much they want to pay for it. So really the customer determines the price. And B, there's a lot of sellers who have absolutely no idea what they're doing. So they drop price to pennies, they end up losing money, never selling on Amazon again, or losing money for the first year, learning from that experience and then doing it properly. And that's one of the reasons why we created our training program, because we want to make sure that the sellers on Amazon are educated. And that's one of the reasons why it doesn't hurt us to teach all of you about how to sell on Amazon. It helps us because that means there's one more seller on the marketplace who knows what the fuck they're doing. And that's important to us. We want each seller to know what they're doing, so it makes it a smoother transaction for everybody. It's just, it's good business all around. I actually have no idea who you are, but you seem cool. Thank you. Burger, please. What you think about 10%? Oh, this is a great question, Manny Cologne. What you think about 10% margin, but a really fast moving product? What you think the profit is only like 196? Yeah. So yeah, absolutely. I'd be all over that. So here it is. The $2 buying cutoff. It's not a hard standard, right? It's not like, if one of my buyers buys a product that we're making 184 on, I'm like going to give them shit. It's like, all right, we're making 184, and in your case, 196. But like, how much inventory is it selling? Can I sell 100 a day? Can I even sell 50 a day? If I'm selling 50 a day, that's 100 products a day. Or if I'm selling 50 a day, that's $100 a day that I'm making money on. Sign me up for that. That's $100 a day. That's $36,500 a year. That's a nice chunk of change. Like, sign me up. If I get 10 of those products, now we're talking $360,000 a year in profit. It's a game changer. So absolutely, Manny. All right, I'm gonna answer a few more questions here and then I'm gonna get out of here. I appreciate each and every one of you. I'm super excited to be doing this. Like I said, this will happen every Sunday for the next 52 weeks. I made a commitment to myself and I'm making a commitment to you right now because I respect all your time and I appreciate you spending your time. Also, check out Clubhouse if you're not on Clubhouse. We've been having some great rooms in there. It's pretty amazing. It's something special is happening there. But let's get back to, you know, two or three more questions and then we'll wrap this up. Looking at repping a small niche company on Amazon FBM, it wouldn't be huge sales, but margins will be okay. It would be my first time doing that kind of thing. Just to learn for bigger. I agree. Do that shit. It's not about, if it's your first time doing it, it's not about the margins. It's really not. You could break even. You could lose $1,000. It's about the experience. The experience you'll gain from doing that deal, representing a brand on Amazon, is worth all of the time invested, regardless of if you make money or not. We've represented so many companies on Amazon, and it's taught me so much. We're literally now we're able to close multi-million dollar brands. We just closed a multi-billion dollar. They're about to sign the contract and send it over to me on Monday. It's a multi-billion dollar company. In 2020, we just started selling their products in February. We did over $1 million in sales with this one company. And the opportunity, our goal is to double, 2.5x that in 2021. So we're gonna take that $1 million in sales to $2.5 million in sales in 2021. So it's all about the experience, my friend. Definitely do that. Any advice for someone that is about to jump on Amazon but thinks it's too overwhelming? Yeah, just listen, don't get caught in analysis paralysis. It's very common. You start doing 40 things at once. You're analyzing this. You're watching a YouTube video on this. You're getting sucked into an Instagram hole. You're getting sucked into a YouTube hole. And before you know it, 4 weeks goes by and you've done absolutely nothing. Just get started. Just go to your local store. Start scanning some products. Go to a book sale. Start scanning some products and start selling stuff. Start selling stuff. The best teacher is selling stuff. The best teacher, hands down, without a doubt, the best teacher is selling stuff. So listen, I appreciate each and every one of you. I apologize if I didn't get to your questions. We've been on here for about an hour now. But like I said, every single week we're going to be doing these. These are posted on YouTube as well. So check them out on YouTube. Smash that subscribe button. Everybody have a fantastic Sunday. Tomorrow's my favorite day of the week. It's Monday. Start the week off fresh. Wake up bright and early. Make a fresh pot of coffee. Drive to work with some stock talk on my radio. Getting ready and prepared to crush the week. So once again, appreciate all of you. Have a lovely evening and stay lit.